this expression of the joint's love for social activism and historical correctness. And we just really
our warrior sister, our revolutionary sister. She's the queen mother of the movement, huh? Come on, somebody. She's a pastor, a luminary, an author, a professor, a leader. And it's not over yet. But we don't want to miss an opportunity to say, you are special to Detroit.
Man.
We welcome you to Detroit. We love you in Detroit. And we're here to present this testimonial to Angela Davis. It's been 40 years. And those of you who are scholars of faith, you know there's something significant about the year 40, huh? It's been 40 years since the acquittal of Angela Davis. How many of you out there have had a poor friend? Intentionally, with a wonderful committee, planned this evening so that it would be just before the national election, because this is a critical election. We wanted somebody to light a fire, ignite like dynamite, for all the people in this community. So we have some dynamite lighters here tonight. One. The Honorable Claudia House Morgan is going to introduce our keynote speaker. And Claudia House Morgan is not just another judge. She's not just another attorney. She's not just another actor. She's magnificent. She's a leader. And an owner. She was one of the people who was at council 40 years ago when we won the acquittal of Angela Davis.
But she has been a hero of mine ever since I found out about her and I met her. And I think that there's so many young people now that need to know her story. So they can
lived almost continuously in California since that time. I have come to Detroit many times for the National Alliance Against Racist and Political Repression, which continued the work of the campaign, attempting to secure the freedom of other political prisoners, challenging racist repression. And I've come under the auspices of the Communist Party. I remember very vividly the rally that took place in the 80s. I can't remember exactly what year it was. But it was a rally against the plant shutdowns as global capitalism was leading to the deindustrialization of this city. And I can remember that the slogan was, Save Dodge Maine. Does anybody remember that campaign? I don't know whether at that time we would have predicted that capitalism would have so thoroughly penetrated the lives of people all over this planet. When we challenged union busting practices then, I don't know whether we could have imagined the extent to which the labor movement would sustain such damaging blows over the coming years. We certainly could not have predicted that the prison industrial complex would become such a profit-generating sector of the global economy, and that here in the United States, 25% of the world's incarcerated population would reflect 5% of the world's population at large. The U.S. has become what we now call a prison nation. And this prison nation is fueled by racism, by structural racism. I don't want to begin by conveying the impression that everything that has happened over the last 30 or 40 years is negative. Because at that time, I don't think any of us could have foreseen the election of a black president. Elections in which there is another unprecedented electoral phenomenon. This black president is running for re-election. That is the first time in history that we've experienced such a thing. And we not only want to contribute to the efforts that will guarantee that the other candidate is not elected. But we want to reflect on the issues which we may have to take into our own hands even after we have elected the best candidate. Sense of newness and uniqueness so quickly. What once seemed utterly impossible is now old hat. How could that happen so quickly? How could we become so jaded? I don't ever want to forget the collective euphoria that occurred when we all learned that Barack Obama had been elected president of the United States of America. I don't want to forget how, for a moment, the city where I live, Oakland, California, was absolutely transformed. People were dancing and singing in the streets. People would stop their cars in the middle of the street to get out and hug someone on the sidewalk. It was absolutely amazing. I don't want to forget that during the inauguration, there was not a single crime committed.
But then there were those
who refused to believe that it was impossible.
Hey.
And there were young people who were social media savvy, right? Who knew how to reach vast numbers of people instantaneously. And these young people had hope, and they refused to believe that anything was impossible. It was not even impossible to elect an African-American president of the United States of America. Now, the campaign that Obama ran was developed around categories that could appeal to any and everyone. And in a sense, they were large, capacious categories and concepts like hope. Everybody wants hope, right? Change. Everybody wants change. The future. And many people who were brought out by that campaign had never before been moved to get involved in electoral politics. But also, many people forgot the limits of electoral politics. They forgot that we were electing a president of the United States. The imperialist, militarist, racist, anti-union United States of America. But still, what was achieved was earth-shaking, and we should not forget that. If, you know, what would the last 4 years have been like had John McCain been I know many of us are disappointed, and it's okay to be disappointed, but let's put that disappointment into context.
Yeah. Thank you.
The economy crashed. Many people expected Obama to be the 21st century FDR, right? With new economic and social programs that would pull us out of the recession or depression. It really has been a depression. However, those who were simply waiting for Obama to emerge as the new FDR had a very warped view of history. Was it really only FDR who gave us, on his own individual initiative, on his own accord, unemployment insurance, a social security? Was it?
No.
It was not. It was masses of people. There were unemployed councils that prevented evictions. If we believe that it was Franklin Delano Roosevelt who was responsible for unemployment insurance and Social Security, then we are absolutely wrong. And I say this to ask you to imagine what it might have been like had we taken to the streets the day after the inauguration. Both to celebrate Obama's election and to pressure him to move on the issues we're all concerned about. Obama had said that he was going to shut down Guantanamo. Guantanamo is still functioning. We should have been out in the streets calling for the immediate closure of Guantanamo.
promised land.
All over the world in the way all over the world. Yes. Are profitable precisely because they do not allow union organizing. And I want to inject something here that may sound a little radical, but that's why we're here to see. I think unions in this country, other countries as well, have to begin to think about organizing prisoners into labor unions so that prisoners cannot serve as union busting labor. And as a matter of fact, prisoners have been trying to organize unions for at least 40 years. As a matter of fact, when I went to jail 40 years ago, during that time in Attica, they called for a labor union. They called for a labor union in California. There was a California prisoners labor union. And they called for minimum wage. They also called for vacation pay.
To create a better world for us all.
And so undocumented youth, it seems to me, represent one of the most important struggles for democracy today. And they say education, not deportation. And this is linked to the demand for education, not incarceration. The Obama administration took some small steps. The DREAM Act wasn't passed, but the Obama administration did take executive steps to guarantee that certain young undocumented students would be able to remain in the country. But this is a tiny step. Even if the DREAM Act had been passed, and it should have been passed a decade ago, even if it had been passed, it would have represented only a very small step toward immigrant rights. And of course, one of the problems with the DREAM Act that some people have pointed out is that not only education, but the military serves as a path towards citizenship. And it's true that if someone serves in the military, he or she does deserve to be a citizen. But we can't allow this provision of the DREAM Act to justify the imperialist incursions of the military. War on terror has been extended from the Bush to the Obama administration, from Iraq to Afghanistan. And that is a very sad thing, because it has promoted the most deadly forms of Islamophobia. And it has been never have thought imagined. And before I conclude, I want to follow that thread regarding Islamophobia to say a little bit about Palestine. But before I do that, let me just list, I think I have two more points. And these are just some of the things we should be thinking about. Some of the issues we should be thinking about. What about women's reproductive rights? And can you believe these Republicans are saying the things that they say? Richard Murdoch from Indiana, who said that if a woman who is raped gets pregnant, then God intended it to happen? What is that about? And Romney, of course, even though he distanced himself from that remark, he did not pull the films in which he stars. He has endorsed Murdoch and is the main figure in his campaign films. Now, this is of course not the first time that a Republican candidate has said something so outrageous. Remember not long ago, Todd Akin? Remember when he said, it is legitimate rape? Legitimate rape! Then he says, quote, the female body has ways to shut down the whole thing. Maybe he knows something from experience, but I've never. 1973, Roe v. Wade. Something then, although we knew then that Roe v. Wade did not necessarily guarantee poor women and black women, Latina women, the right to an abortion if they so chose, because the Supreme Court decision was based on privacy. Based on the right to privacy. And the decision argued that the relationship between a woman and her doctor was a private relationship. What about all those women who don't have doctors? So you see, all of these years, it has been largely middle-class women who have enjoyed the protection of Roe v. Wade. But Romney and his friends want to overturn Roe v. Wade. As a matter of fact, he said explicitly that he will appoint Supreme Court justices who will overturn Roe v. Wade. And the same politicians who are opposed to women's reproductive rights are generally also opposed to LGBT rights. So let's remember that Obama is the first sitting president to endorse gay marriage. We've never before that kind of history. But strangely, there was nothing about this during any of the debates. Now, the last debate was supposed to be a discussion of foreign policy. Obama talked about foreign policy, but it was clear that Romney was totally out of his comfort zone. When moving away from domestic issues, he does not know what to say. And I think that reflects an inability, a larger inability, in the United States of America, of the population to see ourselves as people who live in the U.S., but are an integral part of larger global issues. This is one of the main problems afflicting people in this country. Children learn geography as if the U.S. were the center of the world. And we still don't emphasize the need to learn other languages, which Claudia talked about. As a matter of fact, I think everybody in this country should know how to speak Spanish. Everybody. The world, as I was saying earlier, the wide-reaching influence of Islamophobia was possible precisely because we've been unable to imagine ourselves as world citizens, not simply as citizens of the nation. And this is why we get caught up in attacking immigrants without papers, because we don't even know what citizenship really means. And this deepening and expanding Islamophobia is in part responsible for our failure to understand the occupation of Palestine. And I always point out that I've been active in Palestine solidarity since I was an undergraduate. A long, long time, since the 1960s, where I learned Palestine solidarity at the Jewish university I attended. At Brandeis University, which was founded in 1948, the same year as the State of Israel was founded. And it was there that my Jewish friends and classmates taught me how to engage in solidarity with the Palestinian people. Now, whenever this issue is raised, it is under the guise of the Arab-Israeli conflict. people from recognizing that since 1948, Israel has confiscated land, natural resources, and the future of the Palestinians. The great Israeli historian, Gilad Hakpa, who has an amazing book. I really recommend that you all read it. It is called The Ethnic Cleansing of Palestine. And he points out that half of the indigenous people living in Palestine were driven out beginning in 1948. Half of their villages and towns destroyed. And I'm quoting him, it is indeed hard to understand why a crime that was perpetrated in modern times and at a juncture in history that called for foreign reporters and human observers to be present should have been so totally ignored. And yet there is no denying, he writes, that the ethnic cleansing of 1948 has been eradicated almost totally from the collective global memory and erased from the world's conscience. And it is interesting because we're used to using the term genocide, but it is not so much genocide, argues, that motivated this process, but rather conscious strategies causing the population to flee. It was about deterritorialization. It was about creating a land without people for a people without land. History and exiles from its collective memory. Does that sound familiar? Detroit. But also when you consider the basis of this country we inhabit today, the indigenous inhabitants were completely moved off of their land. They were totally deterritorialized and forced onto small reservations. Now, but let's talk just for a minute, as I wind up, about the struggles of black people in this country. Suppose there had never been any international support for black American struggles. Suppose we did not have people in Europe, in Africa, in Asia, in Latin America supporting African Americans and their quest to be free. Where do you think we would be today? Where would we be? As a matter of fact, many of the cases that led to the development of what we call the civil rights movement were publicized initially not in the U.S. press, but in the foreign press. And then if we think about our involvement in the anti-apartheid struggle, you remember how anti-apartheid activism in the U.S. brought much-needed support to the ANC and eventually held on to bring down apartheid? Why can you not see the Israeli apartheid?
We have certainly felt the fire and the passion and the power that God intended for us this night. Thank God for Professor Angela Davis.